Welcome to the American Medical Association's Private Practice Simple Solutions, part of the Steps Forward Innovation Academy. Before we get started with the content, a quick few housekeeping items. The Private Practice Simple Solutions program is a series of rapid learning cycles designed for private practices to provide opportunities to implement actionable changes that can immediately increase efficiency. Please note that this presentation is being recorded and is for informational purposes only. You should consult a professional advisor for specific advice. Please take a moment to carefully review this notice. And now I'd like to introduce our speaker who will be leading us through today's content, Dr. Janine Engel, Associate Professor of Medicine at the University of Virginia. Dr. Engel, please go ahead and take it away.
Great, thank you so much, Megan. As she mentioned, my name is Janine Engel. I am a general internist and primary care physician at the University of Virginia. I've been practicing medicine for nearly 30 years, and for more than 20 of those years, I've been learning about and teaching the guidelines around documentation and billing for outpatient visits. During the next 30 minutes or so, we'll be reviewing this specifically geared toward private practice physicians. And although I've done academic primary care for my entire career, I believe that we'll be able to help you with some innovative ways to improve your efficiency and documentation in the clinics. The AMA will be releasing a step forward module around this content in the coming weeks to months. And that module includes 5 steps as follows: to understand the current guidelines and recognize their time-saving potential, engage key players around these documentation guidelines, educate the physicians and staff within your clinics, use these new E&M codes, and then develop team documentation workflows. During this webinar, we're going to be focusing on 2 of these 5 steps. To understand these current guidelines and recognize their time-saving potential, and also using the new E&M codes for outpatient documentation and billing. The agenda for the next 30 minutes or so will be to review the key time-saving documentation changes that have been adopted by CMS and CPT during the last several years. Specifically in 2019, some staff and patient-driven documentation, and then in 2021, the outpatient documentation revisions. We'll be using clinical vignettes to demonstrate some of these efficient clinic-based documentation and coding changes. Well, let's get going. These staff and patient-driven documentation changes came about in 2019. In January of that year, as part of the professional fee schedule final rule, CMS allowed physicians and other qualified healthcare professionals who bill E&M services to use the documentation entered by clinical support staff, including nurses and nursing assistants, as well as non-clinical documentation assistants, which they listed as including scribes, students, or even the patients themselves. Again, these are for E&M services. The elements that can be documented by these non-physicians include the history of present illness, the past family social history, including medications, and review of systems. The goal with these changes was to reduce redundancy and documentation burden for the physicians and qualified healthcare professionals. On many of the slides throughout this webinar, you'll see the URLs at the bottom, which allow you to go to some source material to learn more about the important information listed on the slide. In terms of implementing these staff and patient-driven documentation changes, your EMR may have a workflow for this, but it may need to be turned on. This was true of the EMR that we use in my clinic at the University of Virginia. We use Epic, and this type of workflow was available, but had to be turned on within our system in order to be utilized. Also, patients and staff are going to need prompts or training to complete these functions. Our patients are able to enter information through the patient portal, but then I needed training to understand how to take the information that they had entered and then allow it to be imported and entered into the official part of the medical record and into my notes for it to be helpful and to decrease the redundancy of my documentation. As is true both for electronically entered information or if you use information that patients handwrite and you might scan it into your record, the physician or qualified healthcare professional should review and verify the information in order for that information to be counted as part of your documentation. But again, you do not have to redocument the information. Let's move on now to the 2021 evaluation and management documentation changes. In January of 2021, CMS adopted the CPT-driven overhaul of the 1995 and 97 outpatient documentation guidelines. This was a long-awaited change of these guidelines, which were 25 years old. The crux of these changes were that the selection of a level of service for new and established office visits would be dependent upon either medical decision-making or the total time spent on the date of service by the billing provider. The history of present illness, past family social history, and review of systems should still be documented as medically necessary and appropriate for patient care, but would not be counted for billing purposes. These changes were intended to decrease the administrative burden of documentation and coding, to decrease the need for audits, and importantly, to decrease unnecessary documentation in the medical record that's really not needed for the care of the patient. I've included this chart, which shows the necessary documentation for billing purposes across these various levels of service. You can see that the lowest level of new patient visit 99201 was deleted and is no longer available for billing. The lowest level 99211 is a level of service that's available for billing at non-facility-based clinics for a nursing-type visit, but is not a physician-based service. As you can see, the medical decision-making or time are now the drivers for these services, while the history elements as well as the exam should be documented as medically or clinically relevant, but are not counted in terms of elements needed for billing at certain levels. I've also included this slide to give you an idea about the valuation of these various levels of services. The values did increase in 2021 compared to the values in 2020 and prior. I've included the work IVUs, which is a base value that is the same across the country. And then because these webinars are geared toward private practice, the non-facility total RVU, as well as the total non-facility payment for my area, the state of Virginia. This value, meaning the total payment, can change slightly depending on your location based on the GPCI or the geographic price practice cost index. And you'll see at the bottom of the page this URL that allows you to input your location and find these values for your area if you're interested in doing that. Let's talk briefly about the difference between a new versus an established patient and what's needed in order to bill for a new patient or when a patient might be established to you in your practice. A new patient is one who's not received a professional service from a physician or from the physician, meaning you, or another physician of the same exact specialty and subspecialty who belongs to the same group practice in the past 3 years. So there are essentially three elements. It's has the patient seen you or someone who is of your same specialty or subspecialty that belongs to the same group practice, and then there's the time element. specialty is based on your CMS specialty code that's assigned to you or that you pick as part of the credentialing with Medicare. Your group practice is based on your tax ID number. Most group practices have the same tax ID number. This is done for purposes of credentialing and with insurance companies, as well as for quality reporting purposes. So an example here, let's say you're part of a large multi-specialty group practice. In that case, generally all of the physicians or qualified healthcare professionals have the same tax ID number. If a patient was hospitalized in January of 2020 and had a consult done by a general cardiologist in the group, a couple of years later, they come to the group and are seen by a general internist or primary care physician. In this case, the two physicians have the same tax ID number as they're part of the same group, but they are different specialties. It's been only 2 years, but because they have different specialties, this would be a new patient to the primary care doc. If the patient is seen by the same general cardiologist or another general cardiologist in the group, but is seen in February of 2023, these are the same tax ID number and the same specialty, but because it's been more than 3 years, again, the patient could be billed as a new patient. I hope this is helpful in terms of understanding this difference. Let's move on now to reviewing medical decision-making and then time and looking at some clinical examples. The medical decision-making is based on three components. There's the number and complexities of problems addressed at the visit. There's the amount and complexity of data to be reviewed and analyzed. And then there's the risk of complications, morbidity, or mortality of the patient management decisions made at the visit. Your level of medical decision-making will be based on two out of these three elements. So you have to meet for two of the three, not necessarily all three. This general chart shows that for a certain level of service, again, you have to meet for two out of three in order to bill at that level. So for instance, if you think you've met for moderate medical decision-making, you'd have to meet for moderate in two of three, the diagnoses, the data, or the risk, but not for all three of them. And I'll be going through a couple of clinical examples to highlight this. So let's go through each of these components of medical decision-making in a little more detail. For presenting problems, as part of the 2021 update, the CPT work group defined these different types of presenting problems in more detail. This does make it a little easier for us to determine where our patients fall within these different levels of service for presenting problems. You'll see for moderate, the patient will meet for moderate in terms of presenting problems if they have, for instance, two or more stable chronic illnesses or one or more chronic illness with an exacerbation, progression, or side effect of treatment. To get up to high in terms of presenting problems, you have to have a patient present with something more severe, such as a chronic illness with severe exacerbation, progression, or side effect of treatment. Now, what makes it severe? That's not specifically defined, but often this is dependent upon your understanding of their chronic disease and the patient, as well as how severe things can get. That being said, you'll see again at this URL listed at the bottom of the slide, access to the file, which goes through the specific definitions of these various levels of problems. Listed on this slide is the definition of a chronic illness with exacerbation, progression, or side effect of treatment. This is not the severe exacerbation, this is the less severe exacerbation. And you can see here that this includes a chronic illness that's acutely worsening, is poorly controlled, or progressing with the intent to control the progression, but does not require consideration of hospital level of care. And just to back up a slide, this is the one that would place the patient in moderate in terms of the presenting problem. So again, you can go to this file available online that allows you to review the definition of all of these problems. So let's move on to data now. I think the data category has always been the one that is the most complicated or perhaps tedious. However, they have tried, CPT did try to make it a little more comprehensible and understandable in terms of what counts and what doesn't count. So there are essentially four categories in data. There's the tests and documents that you review or order. There's whether you take a history or do an assessment requiring an independent historian other than the patient. It's whether you independently interpret tests that you're not billing for. And then finally, if you discuss the management of the patient or a test with an external source. This is definitely one of the busiest slides and can get a little frustrating at times to review. That being said, I think if you spend a little time with it, you'll end up seeing pretty quickly when your patients or your review of data around a patient encounter falls into the low, the moderate, or the high category here. So for instance, in moderate, you have to meet in one of the three different categories, and meeting in test documents or independent historian is fairly simple if you order a review a few things, because you only need three out of that group. So if you order or review three independent laboratory tests, then you've met there. Or if you review three different notes from an outside source, then you meet in that category. Or if you independently interpret one test, then you've met for moderate. To get to high, it's the same three categories. You need to meet in two of the three. And again, this is to meet for the data element of medical decision making. So again, each individual test counts, whether you order or review. The review of an external note counts, each unique source. Getting a history from someone other than the patient counts. In all of these cases, this data needs to be medically necessary for that particular patient's encounter. Independent interpretation of testing counts in this data category unless you are billing for that interpretation. So it may be in your clinic, you're getting x-rays and billing for those. If that's the case, it counts. Obviously, the billing is where you get the reimbursement and not in this data section of medical decision making. And to be more specific in this discussion with another provider, examples here might include discussing with another physician, such as a radiologist or a surgeon, about a patient if you're a primary care doctor like I am, speaking with a social worker, speaking with a physical or occupational therapist, maybe, calling a psychologist about referring a patient. Specifically mention that the individual could be a facility or organizational provider, such as a hospital, nursing facility, or home health agency. In terms of documenting this, this can be pretty simple in that you can document that you personally reviewed an image or an EKG, that you spoke with a radiologist or pathologist about a test result. You can document that a patient's spouse provided history, or that you discussed the management of a sacral wound infection with some wound care nurses. All right, moving on to risk. The risk rubric did not change a great deal from the previous one. However, there are some changes or additions that are important to note. As has been true in the past, prescription drug management gets you to moderate on risk. And this is prescription drug management that occurred as part of the patient encounter. One addition in the moderate risk category is that the diagnosis or treatment was significantly limited by social determinants of health. Risk can be things like health literacy, ability to pay for medications, housing insecurity, and other similar social determinants of health. Another change that has been made more has been noted to be present now is that a decision not to do something counts as much as the decision to do it. So for instance, prescription drug management can be counted if you discuss the decision or the option of starting a prescription drug such as a statin for lipid management based on cardiovascular risk, but the patient opts not to start the medication. If you document that, this was you discuss with the patient and their decision not to start it, you can still get to moderate risk based on the recommendation or the discussion and the patient's decision not to start prescription drug management. Similarly, in high risk, a decision regarding hospitalization could be a discussion that hospitalization is recommended or an option, but the patient and you together decide to wait and follow up as an outpatient as opposed to going straight to hospitalization at the end of that patient's visit. Let's look at an example around medical decision-making. This is a fairly classic and simple primary care visit. A 68-year-old male presents for follow-up of hypertension and hyperlipidemia. Their blood pressure is well controlled at home and in the clinic, and no labs are needed today. You plan to continue their lisinopril and hydrochlorothiazide. They have hyperlipidemia, and their LDL was in good range 6 months ago. They're tolerating rosuvastatin, and you're going to continue the current dose. You note that a colonoscopy was completed since their last visit and looked good. So how does this pan out in the medical decision-making chart? Well, they have two or more stable chronic illnesses in the hypertension and hyperlipidemia. You really did not review much data. Only one lab test was noted as being reviewed. So that doesn't even get you up to low. Medical decision-making is prescription drug management. Therefore, that gets you to moderate. Again, medical decision-making, you need two of the three to meet. And so you can drop out one. In this case, you'll drop out the data. And therefore, this visit meets for moderate medical decision-making, or a 99214 in this case, based on the documentation of their medical decision-making. I think that many general internists might have billed this as a level three, thinking it's a fairly simple visit. However, based on the coding rubric, this clearly meets for a level four visit. So let's move on now to discussing time. Again, in January of 2021, with the billing changes that were finalized by CMS, all time on the date of service by a billing physician or qualified healthcare professional could be counted in order to bill for outpatient evaluation and management services based on time. And the time intervals for new patients and established patients are listed here. In terms of what could be counted, the following list of activities are things that could be counted toward this total time on the date of service. This is not an all-inclusive list, but are suggestions of things that might be counted. Preparing to see the patient, obtaining or reviewing history, performing an exam or evaluation, counseling and educating, ordering medications, tests, and procedures, referring and communicating with others, documenting, interpreting results, communicating those results, and care coordination, if not separately reported by another CPT code. In addition to redefining both what can count and in terms of billing for time, a prolonged service time of 15-minute increments was approved to be added on to the highest level of service, the 99205 or 99215, if billing based on time. This code, 99417, was written by CPT. Medicare also approved their own code, G2212. This was because Medicare and CPT had a slight disagreement about what the maximum time was before you could add on the prolonged service code. And so you do have to refer to this chart or a similar one available in various places to know the time intervals for the highest level code, the 99205 or 99215, and the point at which you can add on the 99417 for commercial payers, or the G2212 for Medicare. The valuation of these codes is the same, 0.61 work RVUs, and the non-facility payment in the state of Virginia is $32.99 for the G code, which is the only one that I can get a specific reimbursement amount for, as the commercial payers are going to vary based on what you have negotiated with them. So let's look at a potential time example in terms of a patient who presents. So a 48-year-old female with past history of migraine headaches, seasonal allergies, and intermittent low back pain presents for a routine follow-up. She's tearful at the onset of the visit and states that her teenage son's been having difficulties in school and may be using illegal drugs. Her husband has not been coping well and has increased his alcohol consumption. She is working with the school counselor and other resources for her son. She endorses poor sleep, feeling anxious, and increased crying. Her weight is stable. She denies suicidal ideation. She's never experienced depressive symptoms in the past and has never been on medications. You spend time with her and document the following note: assessment and plan, mood disorder, mixed depression and anxiety, reactive. You start sertraline 25 milligrams with a plan to increase to 50 in a week. You make a referral to crisis counseling via your social worker. You personally speak with Dr. Smith, the PhD psychologist in the community, who can see her in 1 week. She contracts for safety, and you schedule a follow-up visit in 3 weeks with you. Her migraine headaches have been stable, and she has PRN rizatriptan for rescue. Her other chronic medical problems are deferred due to the acute mental health interventions that were needed today. You document your total time on this date and for this encounter at 60 minutes, which included the following activities: preparing to see the patient, performing a medically necessary, appropriate exam and evaluation, counseling and educating, ordering medications, tests or procedures, referring and communicating, documenting clinical information, and this time is independent and non-overlapping. This is a fairly standard time attestation pulled from our electronic medical record that has a pull-down menu that allows you to click off what activities you spent time doing. So let's go through how this would be billed or coded if you use medical decision making or time. So in terms of presenting problems, her reactive anxiety depression episode could be an undiagnosed new problem or an acute illness. So this would fall into the moderate category. In terms of data, there really was not a lot, although you might get up to limited with contacting an outside physician. There's prescription drug management. I really don't think we get up into high risk here, although you could argue that with a severe reactive type episode. All that being said, we're probably going to drop out the data. And if we build this based on medical decision-making, it would be a moderate. In terms of time, however, we spent 60 minutes. And so we easily get to a level 5 visit based on time for an established patient. And in fact, we documented 60 minutes total. And this patient is a non-Medicare patient. And therefore, we can actually bill this patient as a level 5 visit plus a 99417 based on a total time of 60 minutes. And so in thinking about time as a potential way to bill for your visits, how might these changes in what counts for time on the date of service alter your approach? Well, you may choose to do some of your prep on the clinic day. You might finish your documentation on clinic day, particularly for patients that were more time consuming or that you had to spend more time with based on what they presented with. Do you have a way to track the time? Because the time can be discontinuous and you need to know your electronic medical record. Perhaps it has a way to track time for you. Epic does track time when you have the encounter open on the date of service. So I have a habit when I go into the room to see the patient, I immediately open their chart, even if I'm not doing anything on it. And I do this so that so that Epic is tracking my time, at least the time that I'm in the room with them. And then of course it tracks any time that I have the chart open that I'm documenting or ordering or doing anything like that outside of the patient's face-to-face encounter. Now it is not perfect. There have been times that I've forgotten to close the patient's chart when I leave the room. I just tap out. If I do that, it continues going for often a couple of hours. That becomes obvious if I check the time signature later and it says I've spent, 240 minutes with the patient, and I know that isn't accurate. So it's not perfect, but it can be helpful. So this gets us kind of to the end of the content of our webinar today. And the action items for all of you are to start asking some questions and thinking about how you might be able to implement these changes within your practice, or maybe you're already doing it. But could your staff or could your patients be documenting or contributing some of the elements of their visit in the medical record to save you some time and documentation? How are you using these 2021 guidelines? Have you altered your templates? Are you using the prolonged service codes when you're billing based on time, and how are you billing based on time? So we will be opening up a discussion board via some links in the resource section of the webinar dashboard. And you'll have the opportunity to connect with me and with your peers on implementation of these changes, some of which are, now more than a year old, a year and a half old. But we want to learn from each other, and I'll be available to answer questions or get into the weeds a little bit on some of these changes. And I'm really excited about that, to learn with you and from you about how you are working with these and what you've done to improve that. So all that being said, this is a list of the office hours as planned for right now. We'll be checking in on the discussion board to see what great information you have to add or questions that you have to add. So on behalf of the AMA and the Steps Forward program, we thank you for listening and look forward to hearing what you have to say and how we can move forward together to improve your efficiency in clinic. Thank you so much.